Good morning, everybody. So today we have with us Dr. Somshila Murthy. She needs no introduction. She is head of cornea and uvea services at LVP Hyderabad. She is very well-known speaker, as we all know. And we are very much delighted to have you, madam, with us for wonderful lectures on scleritis. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Swapnil. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting me and for introducing me, Swapnil. That was really nice, and I enjoy taking these classes or teaching, as you can see. So I'm going to talk about scleritis, but since it's a, although you know it's a rare disease, but it's a rather vast topic in terms of understanding. So what I'm going to try and do is cover clinical features and diagnosis in today's class. I'd just like to know quickly, Swapnil, my slides, I'm sharing them. So is it clear? Can everything?
Yes, ma'am. We can see the slides as well as hear you clearly.
Okay, excellent. So in this class, I'm going to cover definitely the overview and the differentiating points between episcleritis and scleritis. We'll come to the classification. Since all of you are students and not practitioners, so I think it's also good to learn about what is the pathogenesis, what you see if you do a histopathology, and we'll spend time on the clinical features. The other three aspects, maybe not this time, maybe if I get a chance, I can complete it in another class. Otherwise, it will be too much of overload and you will get bored. So everybody knows that scleritis is an inflammation, of course. It's inflammation of the sclera. It's extremely painful. It has a characteristic clinical picture. Patient comes in with very severe pain, complaining of pain that radiates, and it's locally destructive, meaning that it can cause necrosis or it can cause tissue breakdown of the scleral tissue. And it can be associated with systemic diseases, which can be quite grave. For example, we all know that it has association with rheumatoid arthritis and granulomatosis polyangiitis, which earlier we used to call as Wegener's granulomatosis. So these are two diseases which have a very known, well-known association with scleritis, and are also quite serious in terms of the systemic problem. Anybody is asking a question?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So, and then you can also have inflammation in the adjacent areas like the cornea, and the patient can also have uveitis or sometimes even an exudative kind of a huge amount of inflammation. Yeah, for some reason I got muted there. Am I audible? I guess I am. Yeah. So what is the extent? Luckily for us, actually scleral disease is very rare. Scleritis is rare. And in the general population, it's roughly just about 6 cases per 1 lakh population. So that way it's rare. But if you're in a setup, say MGM, where this is a tertiary care hospital, or if any other ophthalmology, which is a tertiary care hospital, you're much more likely to see these cases. And it's also important that even if you're a general practitioner practicing in an area where you're seeing a lot, lots of more of general disease, the patient might still walk into you. So this prevalence data is from the West. It's possible that we have a higher prevalence than what they have reported. They've also reported that close to 50%, so 35 to 50% patients may have underlying disease. And this is more so if the scleritis is a necrotizing kind of a scleritis. So why? What is the seriousness of this is that if you have necrotizing scleritis with rheumatoid arthritis, then the morbidity as well as mortality rates are pretty high. Even if the patients are on treatment for the systemic disease, about 1/4 they found could be dead within 5 years. And about even in the end, as you go on in time, even some patients can die even later on. So that is the importance of this disease. For us to diagnose if the patient has any underlying etiology for the problem. So further on, what are these systemic associations? They can be connective tissue disorders or vasculitic disease, such as GPAs, a vasculitic disease, or SLE. Then in addition to that, a small percentage, maybe 5 to 10%, can have an infectious etiology. The patient can have trauma, or it can be after surgery, and there can be some infection lodged in the sclera. Certain other conditions such as atopy, rosacea or gout are also known to be associated with scleritis. We very infrequently see this. For example, gout, I'm yet to see a single patient who had gout and came in with scleritis, but it has been reported. So the next point is coming to classification. The classification system that was first introduced by Watson and Sohan Singh Harry way back in 1975 or in 76 still holds extremely good. So what they had done is that they had divided scleritis based on how you look, how you see it. So it can be either an anterior scleritis or a posterior scleritis. When you're looking at anterior scleritis, it could be either non-necrotizing or necrotizing. And under non-necrotizing, you can have two versions. You can have diffuse version and you can have a nodular version. So you would say a diffuse anterior scleritis. Or you can say nodular anterior scleritis. For the necrotizing one, they had categorized it as with inflammation and without inflammation. Because in those days, in the 70s, they used to see a lot of patients with rheumatoid arthritis. And since the only treatment for rheumatoid arthritis was corticosteroids and HCQs and sulfasalazine, things like that, the patients would continue to have systemic symptoms as well as scleritis. So they would see a lot of patients with RA with low-grade inflammation. So that was known as scleromalacia perforans, like this picture here. So although they said without inflammation, but in terms of histopathology, there would always be some inflammation. So it's a misnomer. So if you have a patient who has this kind of scleritis, you can see that there is a lot of tissue thinning. You can see almost like a staphyloma formation, but still there is still a lot of activity. So this case you would classify as necrotizing anterior scleritis with inflammation. So that is based on the Watson's criteria. This is a case of nodular anterior scleritis. This is diffuse anterior scleritis. And this is what I mentioned, scleromalacia perforans. There is still some ongoing inflammation in this particular patient. So to this, we have modified the diagnosis or the classification slightly. And you know that you heard about surgically induced necrotizing scleritis. So you can have scleritis even after surgery. So there is surgically induced necrotizing scleritis called SINS, and there is surgically induced diffuse scleritis also called SIDS. So these are a couple of entities that were recognized later on after this classification, and that's why we added to the classification now. Is there any other way of classifying? Yes, there are. So McCluskey and Wakefield, they published their classification system. What they did is that they looked at the area of inflammation, the amount of pain the patient has, what about adjacent structures like the cornea, anterior chamber. So they created 8 components based on all these criteria, and each of this has to be graded as either present or absent or has to be given severity. For example, if corneal involvement is there, then you give a score of 2 or something like that. If the patient has pain and it is severe pain, then you give a score of 4. So based on this, they had a scoring system. So they would score it, a mild scleritis would just get a score of maybe 5 or 5 to 10. A moderate scleritis would hover around 10, and a severe scleritis would be 15 or anything more than that. So this is good to talk about the severity, but it's a very cumbersome system. In the clinic, you really can't sit and do all this grading for the 8 components. So in terms of clinical utility, I think it's not very, very useful for us. The other classification system is the one that was published by Nida Sen and group in 2011. And what they did is that they took 79 pictures of patients who had scleritis of different types, diffuse anterior scleritis, necrotizing scleritis, resolved scleritis. So exactly what I discussed in the Watson's classification. And they sent it across to 4 other graders or other experienced ophthalmologists for scleritis who graded all of them and who agreed on the diagnosis. So this is the grading, standardized grading system where they use photographs. You have to compare against the photograph and then grade the patient for diagnosis. So again, this is good for research purposes and publication, but it's very difficult for a clinical in the setting when you're seeing the patient across the slit lamp. So I would go back every time, I would go back to the Watson's simple classification. So coming to histopathology, I'll try to keep it simple because I know that many of you don't like histopathology. What do we know about scleritis in terms of the pathology? We know that it's a vasculitic phenomenon. We know that there's deposition of chronic inflammatory cells within the stroma, as well as even around the vessels, the blood vessels that are there in skin, there would be deposition of inflammatory cells. That's why you call it vasculitis. So because there's inflammation around the blood vessels or even in the blood vessels. So there were two very good papers which were published. As you can imagine, scleral samples will not be easy to send. Unlike, you know, if you have a pterygium or something like that, where you send the whole sample. Here, if a patient comes in with scleritis, sending a biopsy would be very rare. You would send it only if you're suspecting maybe an infection and you couldn't get anything from scraping, or maybe it's a very challenging case and finally you're resorting to a biopsy. So instead, they studied eyes which are enucleated because of end-stage scleritis, and they also looked at a few biopsy specimens. So what it showed is that, as I mentioned earlier, so this is a histopathological slide, H&E staining, thigh magnification. This is the scleral tissue, which is very loose. The collagen lamellae looks a bit highly disrupted, and there seem to be inflammatory cells just throughout the specimen. So here there are large inflammatory cells, mononuclear. You can see clearly that most of them have a single nucleus. There are hardly any PMNs in the specimen. So it's more always a chronic inflammation in immune-mediated scleritis. Whereas in infection, you can have acute inflammatory cells, PMNs and so on, neutrophils. But in chronic, you'll have mononuclear. So what it's showing is a large population of mononuclear cells, such as lymphocytes, plasma cells. And if you look at this, this is actually a blood vessel because there are RBCs here. And there's perivascular cuffing. So this is the vasculitis part of it. If you look closely, you can see some giant cells also, or macrophages. So this is what you have. This is a pathology in scleritis. Based on immunofluorescence staining, what was further done is that they did the fluorescent staining to see which cells are present where. So they saw that, as I mentioned, general findings, the macrophages all over, there are T cells also, and there are B cells in the perivascular area. So in patients who they knew the diagnosis was systemic, for example, rheumatoid arthritis and so on, they noticed that the majority of cells were B cells. The larger population was B cells, and then the second larger population was the macrophages, which were CD68 positive, which is a specific kind of a subgroup of macrophages. In the idiopathic group, meaning that there was nothing that they could detect systemically, all the tests were negative, but the patient had scleritis, they saw it was the opposite. The majority happened to be macrophages followed by T cells. So what this means in terms of interpretation, is that if you have a patient with systemic disease, so most of the cells are going to be B cells. So you can use a therapy which is directly working against B cells. For example, the biological agents. That's the reason why they're being more and more being used for severe scleritis, and especially scleritis associated with systemic disease, such as RA, GPA, SLE, and so on. And that's the reason why the biologicals will work, because they are, for example, rituximab, it is a B-cell, anti-B cell agent. So that is the importance of knowing pathology so that we can have treatment based on that. Coming to practical management. So when you see the patient coming to you in the clinic, what we need to do is, first of all, figure out, is it episcleritis, or is this patient having scleritis, or is it a masquerade? Once we figure out that, okay, it definitely looks like scleritis, then we have to figure out, is it necrotizing or non-necrotizing? This is very important, because the necrotizing variant is the one that is more often associated with systemic disease. Once we think, okay, it is scleritis, sometimes you can have necrosis, but you can also have a lot of tissue breakdown. So you have to make sure that you're not missing an infection in this particular case, and ask for history of trauma, history of recent surgery. So once you get an answer to these questions, you can figure out which investigation you need to do, and also what would be the management strategy. If you remember the Kansky pictures, very simply, it shows us that in episcleral inflammation, there is engorgement of the conjunctiva, of course, with the conjunctival vessels, as well as the episcleral plexus. So there are two plexus, superficial and deep. Both of them will be engorged or dilated, but the sclera itself won't be affected. So that is episcleritis. Although to look at the patient, it looks like a very angry looking red lesion, sometimes say this nodular component. But the patient, you will not have that severe pain. Almost 99.9% of times, the pain will be mild with just tenderness or foreign body sensations. Patient will come because the family members or somebody else has noticed that when they open, the eye is very red. So the pain is very minimal. And the best point is that when you apply phenylephrine, like you dilate the patient's eye, then most of this redness will disappear, whereas that's not the case in scleritis. So to understand the anatomical distinguished features better, what we are doing is we're doing an OCT. So this is an OCT which is almost like looking at the tissue section, the closest that you can get. So this is the cornea and here it's the iris, just to orient you. So as you trace it, this is the conjunctiva. So this is a patient who actually has scleritis. What you notice is the conjunctival layer is thickened. If you notice here, it's getting normal. And below the conjunctiva, there seem to be some fluid. And this is some shadow here, is actually a prominent vessel in the conjunctiva. So there's inflamed conjunctiva, the subconjunctival fluid. And this is the episcleral area, which is appearing very dilated. And there is a lot of large vessels in the episcleral area also. So perhaps this patient has mostly episcleritis as opposed to another OCT, which I'll show you for scleritis. So what is it about episcleral inflammation? Is that they, as I told you, that it'll blanch with phenylephrine. So this is one of the patients who presented who said, "Doctor, I have a bit of pain and it keeps coming, it's not going away." So I was also doubtful, am I looking at scleritis or episcleritis, because there are some deep vessels over here. So when I dilated the eye, what I could notice is that most of the congestion went away, except of course for this large permanent kind of deep vessels. This can be physiological also. So once I did that, I was quite convinced that this is a patient with episcleritis and I need not worry too much. So what about scleral inflammation? Of course, everything else, as we saw in the episcleral, episcleritis is dilated, tortuous, swelling in all these regions. In addition, the sclera is swollen. So that's the reason why you'll see this hue, which is way different. So it's a deeper hue, brownish looking or dark red looking in the case of scleritis. So the importance of episcleritis is that some of these patients can have systemic disease like vasculitis or connective tissue disorders. Some of them can be due to local conditions. But the best part is that it is not associated with vision loss. So don't overtreat them with steroids, because the disease itself will not cause a permanent problem to the patient. So these are some of the list of diseases that can be associated with episcleritis, including certain drugs that can cause it, and including herpes zoster, herpes simplex, syphilis, and so on. But honestly speaking, I have really not seen patients. I've seen many patients with episcleritis, but maybe a few of them come in with known diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis or something like that. But I've really not detected a new case. So patient comes to me with episcleritis and I do a detailed evaluation with investigations. In my experience, I've never come across any systemic disease for most of them. So of late, I've stopped investigating also for episcleritis. So you remember the daylight examination dictum that we always say in ophthalmology. Of course, in the clinics, most of the time, there's no daylight. So use a clinic light that you have and examine the patient off the slit lamp. If this patient, if you just look, you know, even the torch or just put the patient on slit lamp, we'll just see that there are a few dilated vessels here and there. We miss most of 90% of the findings. You have to ask the patient to look into various directions of gaze. And then you see that there's a diffuse congestion, quite severe, and it correlates with the patient's history of severe pain. So look at this here, whereas opposed to this. So you have to examine the patient by making him or her move his eye in all directions of gaze. And that's when you'll have the true picture coming up. So looking at this, my optometrist had said patient has diffuse episcleritis. But when you look at this, you know obviously that it is scleritis. And the pupil is also dilated here. So this is post-dilation that you're looking at. Of course, if the patient walks in with this kind of picture where there is old episodes, so there is a lot of thinning here, or scleromalacia perforans, or a large nodule, then you obviously won't miss the diagnosis and the patient will also complain of pain. So you can clear cut, you can make the diagnosis. Here you would call it as necrotizing scleritis, or like a scleromalacia perforans. Here would call it as necrotizing scleritis with inflammation. This would be nodular scleritis. And straight away you'd start investigating the patient for scleritis entities. So when you apply the slit to a patient of nodular scleritis, you'll notice that the anterior part of the slit is very well seen, whereas the posterior part of the slit kind of disappears. That's because of the nodular lesion. What I've noticed is that when you have episcleritis, because the lesion is more superficial, even the posterior part of the slit can be visible. So that's one more way for us to differentiate between episcleritis and scleritis if it's nodular on the slit lamp. So you know that you have this red-free filter that is always there, and the textbooks actually tell you to use it. And I used to think that it's not very useful in scleritis patients, although the textbook tells you to use it. But I realized that when I had one patient with what was like a diffuse anterior scleritis, patient's pain was not that high. So I was wondering what I should do. Should I just use topical steroids? And then I saw that, oh, there's a lot of congestion in this area. But look, the other areas is normal, so there's no congestion here. But when you apply the red-free filter, the true picture comes up. Of course, the congested area is very congested. Norm-looking area, actually there are no blood vessels here. So there's a capillary dropout. So contrary to this being normal, actually this is an area of old ischemia. So the patient previously had an episode which might have involved this area, and the capillaries have dropped out. So when I investigated this patient, patient actually turned out to be ANCA, ANCA positive. So this patient may have systemic disease GPA, but definitely is ANCA positive scleritis. So I knew what I had to do. So that's the importance of using the red-free filter. Any questions? So are we reaching the end of this session, Swapnil?
Madam, we have time. We can carry on.
Okay. So the other aspect, so then coming to diffuse anterior scleritis, these are all four examples of patients with diffuse anterior scleritis. It can be quite severe for the patient, but amongst the various scleritis entities, I think it's a slightly better prognosis, because very, very often these patients do not have systemic disease. We treat them for the ocular condition, they often get quite better. So this is a patient with very angry looking diffuse anterior scleritis. This is the same patient. When you ask a patient to look the other direction of these two are from a different set of patients. So when you ask a patient to look up, you can see that there is uveal hue over here. This is not old necrotizing scleritis. What happens is that even in diffuse anterior scleritis, the healing that happens causes the scleral fiber to thin out, to become thinner. And you can see the uveal hue. So this is not necrosis. It is still non-necrotizing scleritis. There's another patient who has these ischemic looking nodules over here. These are not infection infiltrates. There's one more here also. And you can just notice that the peripheral cornea is showing some whitishness because of inflammatory cells over there. So this is a case of, it's an early necrotizing scleritis. This will now break down further and you'll see tissue destruction here. So this is an anterior scleritis necrotizing type. This example of nodular scleritis. There's a large nodule over here. There is a smaller nodule which almost appears like a pus point, but it's not. This one has a small ischemic nodule in this area, which you see on the red-free filter. There's again, you can very well make out that you can see that even clinically, but it's just that it's highlighted here that all the blood vessels are stopping short and there are no blood vessels in this area. So this is a focus in the sclera, which is undergoing ischemic necrosis in front of your eyes. And this is going to break down, leading to tissue breakdown. So this patient is more likely to have an associated systemic disease. You have to treat very aggressively. These are examples of scleromalacia perforans. The ocular pictures are both from the patient on the right side of your screen. These are two different patients. This is an elderly man who has a swan neck deformity of his fingers. This is a younger female patient who has ankle effusion. So both of them have rheumatoid arthritis, and both of them could well have scleromalacia perforans, which is this kind of clinical picture. So you may have heard about posterior scleritis, and we had discussed it in the classification also. Posterior scleritis is a diagnosis that you need to keep watching for. So it won't pop out at us, unlike anterior scleritis, which is very stormy and very easy to differentiate from any other cause of red eye. In posterior scleritis, the patient will complain of pain, but the anterior portion of the eye will not show congestion. Patient can have painful eye movements. And really the pain would be out of proportion what you can see anterior. Very often the vision also may be normal unless the scleral inflammation is involving the central part of the eye as well. So there's a patient who's had a similar clinical picture, severe pain, anterior segment looking nearly normal. There's no scleral inflammation. And when you examine the retina, you see a large lesion here, which initially you think is choroiditis. In fact, FFA was done. And what FFA shows is that there's multiple areas of blocked fluorescence. and then there is a hyperfluorescence in a small in an initially like this, but later on there's a pooling as well in the sea, and there appears to be some subretinal fluid as well. So B scan is a classic giveaway. When you do B scan, you do see that there seems to be choroidal thickening, but classically you see that there is fluid behind the choroidal layer, so in the subscleral space. The classic T sign is made by the optic nerve head, that is the vertical part of the T, and the subscleral fluid which is there tracking over here behind the choroid, that makes the horizontal part of the T. So this is T sign, which is seen on B scan. You may not see T sign in each and every case, but you may just see a lot of choroidal thickening and the subtle subscleral fluid that is noted here. So these are all examples of posterior scleritis. And it doesn't have to be classic T sign, but once you see any fluid over here, so it is an inflammation. So rather than a diagnosis of choroiditis or exudative kind of a situation, you make a diagnosis of scleritis for these patients. So you can have variants of these entities. This is a patient, 35-year-old, who came in with this ischemic or necrotizing scleritis, as well as the peripheral cornea showed thinning as well as breakdown of tissue. A very angry, congested looking eye. In fact, initially we thought it was infection. We did scraping and so on, and it required a lot of systemic workup, and we had to change our diagnosis once we got the complete systemic workup done by the rheumatologist. So this particular patient was also ANCA positive and even had lesions in the lung, and finally was diagnosed as necrotizing scleritis with PUK with Wegener's granulomatosis. So when you have necrotizing scleritis, especially with PUK, there's a very, very high chance of systemic disease association. So you should keep investigating for that. Then this was another very challenging case. The patient came way back, almost 17 years now. She's still on follow-up. And at that time, she was diagnosed to have diffuse anterior scleritis. As you can see in both the eyes, this clinical pictures here, and the peripheral cornea is also showing these infiltrative lesions, really. This is spillover inflammation in the cornea. So again, on the dictum that scleritis with peripheral corneal involvement is more likely to have systemic inflammation or systemic disease. So we kept investigating the patient. We did multiple investigations, but whatever we did, everything were all negative. So we initially got nothing in terms of etiology. Patient was treated meanwhile with oral steroids, methotrexate, cyclophosphamide, but the patient kept having relapses. So till almost 2 years later, she walked in with the saddle nose deformity. So there was a sudden breakdown of the cartilage, of the nasal cartilage, and the patient came in like that with this deformity. And that was when, along with the help of the rheumatologist, we could make a diagnosis of scleritis in a patient with relapsing polychondritis. She also had arthralgias all this time, which I forgot to mention. So since then, she came in 2003. In 2005, we had a diagnosis for her. So since the past 15 years, she's been on systemic immunomodulators. Currently, she's on biological agents to keep her disease, the primary disease of relapsing polychondritis, under control. But if she doesn't take anything, then she, of course, has debilitating joint inflammation. But there is also a problem of the patient having even systemic vasculitis. So they can have high mortality. A patient with RP, relapsing polychondritis, left untreated, so the mortality within the next 2 years or 5 years is almost 75%. So at least we came to a diagnosis for this patient, and maybe that's one outcome, good outcome that we have. We've saved the patient in that way because she's been on continuous treatment. The third example I have for you is an elderly lady. This lady came in with a diagnosis of GPA, of granulomatosis polyangiitis, or formerly known as Wegener's granulomatosis. So when she first came in 2014, she had a recurrence of her scleritis. So this is recurrent scleritis. Again, you can see it's a necrotic type or necrotizing scleritis type. And the reason she was sent to us is because the patient was recently diagnosed to also have active pulmonary cough. So she had GPA. Her rheumatoid factor was also positive, so they had also labeled her as RA. Often, the rheumatoid factor can be positive. It may not mean that the patient has rheumatoid arthritis, but it definitely means that there's something systemic going on. and recent diagnosis of pulmonary cox. So they had the rheumatologist and her treating physicians had started the patient on oral steroids as well as anti-cox therapy. So what our management was supposed to be is to, the reason they sent the patient to us, whether the patient needed a patch graft or not for this area which was rapidly getting destroyed. So what we did is we actually did nothing much because we thought that it should get controlled with the help of the immunomodulators, and we just waited on this patient. So her status improved within the next few months, and after she received adequate ATT, the patient then started on azathioprine, which is an immunomodulator agent. And in these patients, you can monitor the disease activity of the body by repeating C anchor. So whenever the patient is adequately immunosuppressed, C anchor from positive that the patient had may become negative. But unfortunately, the patient again developed pulmonary pneumonia. This time it was due to aspergillosis. And again, all the immunomodulators had to be decreased for the patient. And then she was started on antifungal. Luckily, she recovered from that also. So the clinical pictures show that this was when she first came in. This was after she started on with treatment. From our side, nothing much except to continue the oral steroids. And subsequently, this area became totally resolved. The scleritis resolved. Of course, there's a staphyloma formation, but the eye is tectonically stable. Unfortunately, over the next 2 years, that particular patient, she survived till 2018. But after that, again, she succumbed to systemic infection. So it is quite challenging for them to handle these kind of patients who keep developing multiple systemic infection. The last example I'm sharing with you is of a 44-year-old male. He gave 2-month history of pain and redness, and he said that at onset, there were lesions on the forehead. So this is what I'm seeing. It's a sort of a diffuse anterior scleritis. Now I'm throwing this case open. We have 3 minutes before this meeting ends, and we resume again. So I'm throwing this case open to you people. Tell me what you think about this patient. So it's 44-year-old, 2-month history of severe pain, redness, etc. And he had some lesions on the forehead at the onset. What you're seeing here is a diffuse anterior scleritis kind of picture, as well as something else. I won't tell you what is the something else. I need you guys to answer. So Swapnil, you would know your fellows and residents, so you can randomly ask somebody to answer for me.
Yes, Deepanshu or Trupti, you can put some points regarding.
Yeah, there's no right or wrong. Just you can answer whatever you think.
Corneal, this scarring is there actually here over the cornea. Also, ma'am, there's a history of severe pain, so. We would like to see posterior segment as well, apart from this.
But remember I said that in posterior scleritis, all patients have to be examined as a whole. So assuming that I've done a complete examination and I found the retina normal, these are the only findings the patient has. All scleritis patients, yeah, I totally agree with you. It's an important point, I forgot to bring it up, that don't stop at just anterior segment examination. You must examine, because some of these cases, we do see some congestion anteriorly, and patients who we initially diagnosed with anterior scleritis turned out to have posterior scleritis as well. I don't know if there's something like a pan scleritis. Maybe some patients have something like that.
So, ma'am, if these scars are there, then we will have to ask for previous episodes if there were any to rule out associated viral infection.
Yeah. Yeah, so very important. So past episodes of similar such, it may not have been scleritis, but it could have been more of a viral keratitis. But here the patient gives a very important history, lesion on forehead.
And that can, we can think of her previous episodes of herpes zoster, if there were any, depending on what type of.
Yeah, so this, we have less than 1 minute, Swapnil.
And we can use another ID to start.
As people had correctly pointed out, the patient had these corneal lesions, and the patient also had history of lesion on forehead. So the final diagnosis was 8-0. And with that, we had diffuse anterior scleritis as well as the corneal part of the inflammation. So we started the patient on oral medication. The patient before this was receiving oral steroids and not getting better. And every time the patient would decrease the oral steroids, the patient would be coming back again with more pain. So we started the patient antivirals, and this is the OCT picture showing what this shows here is that, as you've seen in the previous picture also, that you can figure out now, this is the cornea, this is the iris, and this is the conjunctiva here. The total width of the scleral tissue and the conjunctiva typically is about 700 microns. But here it's about 1100 microns. So there's definitely thickening. The conjunctiva looks okay. The episcleral tissue shows that there is edema and there is some slit-like spaces here. And the scleral tissue, deeper one, shows there's disorganization of its normal looking architecture. There are some dilated vessels as well. So when you treat the patient, we expected the patient to show very quick resolution. Patient came back 2 weeks later. The corneal lesions had decreased or almost disappeared, but the scleral inflammation appeared to have increased, but the patient was clinically much better. So we continued on the same lines. The OCT at 2 weeks later still shows that there is a lot of swelling of the sclera. But at 1 month after starting treatment, there's complete resolution. So you can see there's no congestion here. There is some scleral thinning over here. And just far periphery, there are faint lesions. And otherwise, the patient had completely resolved at 1 month. The OCT also showed that there was almost near normal architecture at 1 month. So this was a very important slide, actually. Unfortunately, I was mute. So I'm going to repeat this. So how to proceed in a case of scleritis? That means what are the most important factors that will help us manage the patient? So I've divided it as these factors. One is that when a patient comes with scleritis, I look at what is the anatomical diagnosis. Second is, what is the age and is it a male or a female patient? What is the severity? Severity at entry level itself. And is there a systemic problem? So anatomical diagnosis, how does it help me? Is that I know that if the patient has a diffuse anterior scleritis, these are slightly better for managing. And I can just probably start the patient on a course of oral steroids and gradually taper it and may not start a second drug like immunomodulators. Very often, with one course of oral steroids, the patient can get better. If the patient comes back with recurrence, then I look at starting immunomodulators. This is, of course, assuming that I've done a complete workup and ruled out other things. So if I have a very young patient, then I know that there's a higher chance that something may come positive down the line. So I have to be on the watch out for these patients. A pediatric patient, I wouldn't want to give high-dose oral steroids. Young patient, I wouldn't want to give a very drug like cyclophosphamide, which can cause sterility and so on. So the age is a big factor in deciding both the management and what could be the diagnosis. On the other hand, a very elderly patient who's 70 plus and so on, this kind of patient is again less likely to have something systemic because he or she is now elderly. So if they had something systemic, it would have manifested by now. Also, elderly patients, oral steroids, again, just like young patients, you don't want to start them on oral steroids because of the side effects. So you have to think of immunomodulator rather than a full dose of oral steroids. Coming to severity, so if a patient comes into the clinic with very severe disease, I'm not going to wait even for that 1 week that I need to get the investigations in place and then decide, okay, this may be this and so on. I'm going to straight away start the patient on treatment within the same or the next day itself, within the next 24, 48 hours. Otherwise, the patient is going to have severe pain, of course, but also the tissue destruction is going to be very active. So for these patients, you don't have to wait for etiological investigations. Of course, you have to make sure that the patient is fit to receive oral steroids, doesn't have uncontrolled hypertension or diabetes. So you can't just start it off. You have to have a physician clearance for that. But in very severe disease, you may not wait for the investigations. Lastly, if the patient comes in with a systemic component or if the patient comes in with, you've done the lab test and something comes positive, meaning that there is a systemic component, these patients, I would start the patient straight away on, of course, oral steroids and as well as an immunomodulator agent such as methotrexate. Even the patient with very severe disease, I would also, these two categories, straight away start the patient on steroids and immunomodulators. So, which brings us to lab investigations. Is there a chance of not doing lab investigations? The answer is no. All patients with scleritis, whether it's unilateral versus bilateral, whether it's non-necrotizing or any type, all patients with scleritis need to be investigated, but all patients with episcleritis need not be investigated. If it's persistent or if it's recurrent, then these are the cases where you need to investigate perhaps. But as I told you, that I've hardly ever got anything for episcleritis patients, but still, if it's multiple times coming up for the patient, then it's better to do at least one round of investigations. And of course, if you're suspecting an infection, then you need to take different kind of investigation, like scrapings or, and so on. So what are these investigations? So just to divide them, we can do, especially because our patients all have limited money with them, so we can do a sort of a screening evaluation. This will give you some information on whether the patient has a systemic entity as well. And some of the investigations will be useful for us to start the patient on therapy. So my screening evaluation would be complete blood count, ESR or CRP, definitely rheumatoid factor. I usually myself don't order the anti-CCP, which is another test for patients with rheumatoid arthritis. I leave that to the rheumatologist if RA factor comes positive or if I have a suspicion for rheumatoid arthritis. And of course, we do a serum ANCA, ANCA test, which is a very important test to rule in or rule out the diagnosis of GPA or vaginal granulomatosis. So serum ANCA is a very useful test. So never miss it for patients with scleritis, because both the sensitivity and the specificity is in the high 90s. It's about 94-95%, or maybe even higher than that. So if you have a positive ANCA, you know that there's a high chance that the patient does have a systemic entity. It may not be outright GPA disease, but it's ANCA positive scleritis. So these patients need immunomodulators, need therapy for a longer time. Otherwise, their scleritis behaves very aggressively. We do anti-nuclear antibodies testing. It's a very non-specific test. As you know, that a lot of patients, like about 15%, even normal healthy individuals can have positive ANA. ANA positivity is associated with SLE. So for a male patient, if you get ANA positive, it means really nothing unless the titer is very high. So very high titer, like say 100 or something, in a male patient, we would attribute significance. Otherwise, in a male patient, it's not significant. If it is positive, then you proceed with the next test. Of late, we've seen that there's a resurgence of syphilis. So we're doing TPHA testing for all patients where we suspect, or with all patients with screening evaluation. And of course, we'll do PPD and X-ray test, not because we're thinking that tuberculosis is the etiology, but because the association of positivity of this disease in Indian population. So it's better to do that in order to make sure that, you know, you don't have to treat the patient for tuberculosis also. So these are the points that I just made. The rheumatologists also like to do the HLA panel. We ophthalmologists don't, but when you send the patient to rheumatologists, they do B27, B51, 52 panel as well. And so in the case of viral suspicion, then we need to do not systemic viral titers, but sometimes we might take ocular samples. But this is really very few cases that where we can take an ocular sample for PCR. So actually, it's really not practically very useful. So how do you interpret is one more thing. So a positive mantis, I just told you that doesn't mean that the patient has tuberculosis as a cause, but it's positive because there's a high probability of being positive in Indian population. So we can divide the investigation into three categories. One is to manage the patient. So to manage the patient, we do CBC, RBS, and the X-ray or the HRCT, Mantoux test, and all of these, because we're going to start the patient on immunosuppressants, steroids, as well as other agents. The other set of investigations was for etiology, which we just discussed. So in addition, if an ANA is positive, then we do dsDNA and other antibodies that are there in the ANA profile. And HLA-B27, as we just discussed. So this will give us some idea about etiology. And there are certain local investigations. Anterior segment fluorescein, we don't do it, but it's mentioned. And ASOCT, I showed you, now we're doing that fairly extensively. We might need a B scan in case of posterior scleritis, sometimes even UBM. Microbiological workup if you're suspecting infectious scleritis. Impression cytology in the rare case of ocular masquerade, which looks like scleritis but turns out to be a tumor like OSSN. And scleral biopsy in cases where there's infection and we couldn't pick it up in the scrapings. All right, so these are just some more examples of OCT, which I will not go through in the interest of time. Instead, I'd rather leave this time for discussion. So I'm going to stop the presentation over here, and the rest of the time, I don't know how much time we have remaining, but definitely I'd like to use that for you folks to ask questions or
We have around 15 minutes for discussion, madam.
Okay, good, great.
Hi, Somshila. That's a very nice presentation that you gave. In Hi, Indian context, is Samrat. It,
yeah, in, of course,
in Samrat. Indian, in Indian context, sometimes we get confused with necrotizing scleritis, whether it's infectious or non-infectious. So, so that I think is a challenge for us compared to the West, where infections like fungus or nocardia or acanthamoeba, these things would be less of a thing. So here. That particular case where you have scleritis with lot of tissue breakdown, I think you need to rule out active microbial etiology as with a corneal scrape. Just wanted to emphasize that.
Yeah, very good point, Samrat. In the very beginning slides, I had emphasized that. So when you have what looks like necrotizing, so it's scleritis with necrosis, you watch out for an infectious etiology. And some of these patients, we have noted that they don't recall any history of trauma, and they're not post-operative patients. So we don't know how they got the infection, but seems like we can get scleral infection even without previous history of trauma.
And the other point that I wanted to make was that phenylephrine, whatever classifications, even Watson's or SAINS, they use 10% phenylephrine, which currently is not available in the Indian context. Yeah. So sometimes, following those kind of gradings or classifications that you rightly did say also, they are not sometimes very relevant or contextual in our setting currently.
I think the blanching test with phenylephrine, whatever concentration we have available with us, whether it's 2.5 or 5%, it's mainly to differentiate between the few cases of episcleritis where it's multiple times recurrent, or they have pain which is sort of in between. It's a moderate amount of pain. So you're kind of confused whether this is scleritis or episcleritis. And sometimes you might have a patient with scleritis who really doesn't have that severity of pain, especially those patients who are already on treatment. Maybe they're using oral steroids or at a sort of a low dose oral steroids, or they have a high pain threshold, or it's scleromalacia performance. So these patients don't have severe pain. So I find this the one test that I can really say works for me all the time to differentiate is the blanching test. This is very reliable in that way. So otherwise, it's good just for those of us, the residents and everybody who's learning, to do this test and to actually see in front of your eyes. That especially in episcleritis, in a routine episcleritis, it's remarkable how the congestion disappears after you use this drug.
And the other thing that you really pointed out, and I find it very useful, is taking the patient out of the room and seeing under the daylight, because then the scleral picture, scleritis, becomes much more evident, where the hues of the colors become more evident. So that also I think is a very useful thing. Sometimes we don't take the patient out into the corridor.
Yeah, absolutely. And the more senior you get, the more you're habituated to just putting the patient on the slit lamp. So I think it's very important not to do that, but examine the patient with the torch or with the lamp in the room, or as Samrat said, that take the patient to daylight and examine the patient there.
Yes, ma'am. And another important thing what you have pointed out is seeing in red-free light. So that also gives very important finding, like capillary dropout areas and all. Ma'am, I have one very basic question. Sometimes we get this nodular kind of thing within the patch of scleritis. So sometimes it becomes difficult to identify whether it is infective or non-infective. So are there any specific signs or some in your experience what we should look for to see whether clinically it looks infective or what?
So I can tell you very honestly, Swapnil, that whatever when you write a book chapter or when you characterize it as infection, non-infection. All that fails, it's only the patient sometimes that will tell you. So there have been times when the patient came in with immune-mediated sclerotis. I thought it's infection, I did scraping, and then finally realized it's not infection and the patient improved after I started oral steroids. Then there's been cases where we just went ahead as immune-mediated sclerotis, started the patient on oral and topical steroids, only to see a worsening, and then you are aghast to see that it's fungal sclerotis, or we had a patient with no cardio also. So ultimately, the last differentiating feature is a therapeutic trial. So the only thing that I can say for sure is that every single patient of immune-mediated sclerotis improves with oral steroids. So if you give the patient full dose of oral steroids and still there is no improvement, or it's almost equivocal, then to me, that's a warning sign that we're not looking at immune-mediated sclerotis. It can either be infection or it could be masquerade. So when I went through the few cases where we burnt our fingers and we saw that one thing was not responding to oral steroids in the way that you expect to. There may be some response, but not in the way that you expect to. So that to me is ultimate. So it's a therapeutic trial ultimately.
Ma'am, I want to add another thing is that in Indian context, if we think about infective, we should keep tuberculosis also as one of the differential, because we happen to see a case and that we published subsequently. In that case, a lady presented with nodular sclerotis, and whatever treatment we gave, she was not improving, waxing and waning kind of presentation she was having. So what we did is we took a small scleral biopsy and we could document a bacilli in that. And subsequently, she went on to receive ATT and she didn't have recurrence in that.
Yeah, so we've also had a similar such cases. So especially the nodular type. And they don't have pus points. They don't break down. They don't show necrosis also. So again, it takes a while. Exactly like your case, also had a similar such patient. So it takes a while for us to come to the final diagnosis. There are a couple of questions here. Mona Lisa has asked how to manage recurrent sclerotis, where all the lab investigations are not conclusive. So Mona Lisa, once you make sure that there's nothing else systemic, so it depends. What I try to do is start the patient with low dose topical steroids and then keep them on maintenance dose with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory eye drops. Sometimes that works. Sometimes you need to use full dose topical steroids and then maintain them for a longer time. So you start off with Prednisone and then maintain them with a low dose, kind of like low tapered of FML for a while, and then take them off it and see how they do. Still, if they don't, so if I have a patient who really needs a drop of topical steroid almost all the time, then I'd probably start the patient on an immunomodulator. So there are maybe, in my experience, one or two patients where I started them on oral methotrexate for this kind of, they needed topical steroids almost all the time. But these are very rare. Most of them, by going around with these three or four drugs that you have in your bag and a lot of vocal counseling to the patient, telling them that it's not a dangerous disease, you won't lose your vision, but using steroids can cause side effects, so let us not use too much of it. So most of them, you have to sort of counsel them and get them going in that way. The other question is about which do you use immunomodulator. My first line immunomodulator is always methotrexate. That's because it's very easy to use. It's the baseline workup is simple. You can step up the drug very rapidly, and the side effects, in my experience, have been very little. And the best part is that it's very inexpensive for the patient. So that's a reason to choose it. And just in continuation to that, Akansha has asked that, if there's a patient on sclerotis with methotrexate 12.5, there's an episode of sclerotis recurrence, will you consider stepping up methotrexate or consider? So 12.5 is not working for the patient. I'll definitely first consider stepping up to 20 milligrams. So for that recurrence, I would either restart a short course of oral steroids or give a periocular injection of oral steroids, of topical, of periocular injection of steroid, depending on how bad the recurrence is. And also step up methotrexate to 20 or 25 milligrams. I think that would work. Sachin has asked, is there any telltale sign of infectious sclerotis? Telltale signs are there. So if you have a patient with multiple areas of small nodules, especially in the watershed areas, 5-6 millimeters from the limbus, Some of them can have pus points. These are the telltale signs, but sometimes you might have a single nodule and it just looks very similar to nodular sclerosis. So you have to have a sort of, it's better to have a higher degree of suspicion for infection in these cases. And it's I think it's still worth it if you scrape sometimes to err on the side of infection and not miss it. So people have often asked actually this particular question, CD has asked about trial of Pedfort or indomethacin or systemic steroids must for nodular anterior sclerosis. So because it's a nodule, so what happens is that there is an area within it which is perpetuating the inflammation, and there are a lot of giant cells and monocytes and plasma cells and so on in that nodule. So a topical agent probably will not address the pathology. And that's why even for nodular anterior sclerosis, yes, you could try topical steroids or an indomethacin or something like that and see if they improve a lot. But because in our practice, most of the patients we get are not just the de novo cases, but they may have had treatment elsewhere, somebody else has already seen them. So in my practice, most of them, I start them on a course of oral steroids. The commonest history, what is the commonest history that you found, Sachin has asked, in infectious sclerosis? And what percentage of all sclerosis in your practice are infectious? So in our tertiary care center, we have 14%, we've done that calculation, are infections, which is quite high. And the commonest history that you found is, it's a split between history of trauma and previous surgery and no history. So it's like one third, one third, one third. So we have last few more minutes, only 5 minutes.
Another point that I would like to make out here is for episcleritis, which is much more common than scleritis. And sometimes patients come on a, you know, a recurrent basis. So yes, there probably our treatment should be quite minimal. And we should counsel the patient saying that this is a non-blinding condition. Because if you don't counsel, then if we don't treat the patient without counseling, patient tends to go elsewhere. And then when they come back, they either come back with cataract or, you know, with raised IOP, because other people would treat these patients with a lot of topical steroids. So that counseling part in episcleritis is very important, so that, you know, unnecessary treatment or over-treatment with steroids are not done.
Yeah, that's a very important point, because these are young patients, and young patients have that impatience. So they want to get better in no time at all. So the counseling is very important. The two questions unanswered. One was about what are the agent you'd use for elderly and pediatric patients in terms of the biological agents. So elderly patients, I would be a little cautious. I don't think I have any elderly patient on biologicals at this point. If they already have rheumatoid arthritis, then these days we're using adalimumab, the biosimilar that is available in India, which is a bit cheaper. And in patients where I do use biologicals, the younger patients with GPA and refractory sclerosis, rituximab, although it's very expensive, is really the drug of choice for these patients. We have used it for when nothing else would work, and it's worked very well. Sachin has asked, should we do treatment on our own or with internists? So it depends on how much of your practice is with these patients. If you're seeing them a lot, you might as well as get experience. Also depends on where you're practicing. Do you have somebody else who you can collaborate with? It's great to have somebody to collaborate, whether it's internist or rheumatologist, because they can take out that factor from our practice. We can concentrate on what we need to do, and they can do the systemic workup and investigations. But if there's nobody else, you're the only doctor, then you have to manage everything. So we do, for our less affording patients, we are doing everything. Luckily, we have an in-house physician. For a more affording patient, we send them to rheumatologist. There are a couple, 2-3 more questions. I don't know how much time we have, Swapnil. Not much.
Ma'am, 3 minutes more.
Yeah. So do you use subtenon? I don't use subtenon tricot in anterior sclerosis. I use it as transseptal. So just like giving a peribulbar block, lateral 1/3, medial 2/3, just take the 26 gauge needle and in the orbital flow. So it's an orbital flow steroid. I don't use subtenon because still I have the trepidation that they can be, it can cause tissue necrosis and so on. So, but transseptal works equally well. And how often can it be given? Maybe so far I've given it maybe twice to one patient, but otherwise typically just once does the trick. And this is more for patients who come in with in between recurrences. So just to take care of the recurrence rather than starting an oral steroid for the patient. Somebody asked about antivirals, and if the patient is not tolerating acyclovir, you can start the patient on valacyclovir, which is better tolerated by most patients, but it's a little bit more expensive. But my preferred antiviral in IDZIDO is still acyclovir because of the cost. Most of our patients, they complain a lot if you give them expensive medication. So I still prefer to use acyclovir. So any risk of secondary glaucoma with transseptal? Of course, there's always a risk of secondary glaucoma with any steroid injection. So yeah, that's a side effect. But you have to just keep always weigh the risk versus the benefit. So if I have a patient where they have a recurrence and I have to start them on oral steroids again, so the systemic side effects are more. The dose of transseptal is about 20 milligrams. I think we're almost out of time.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank Swapnil.
Thank you, Dr. Somshila.
Thank you, everyone, for this.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving such an elaborative presentation on scleritis. I mean, it was a very nice hearing from you and answering all important, relevant questions. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.